You are watching DHTV, the television program service of California State University, Dominguez Hills.
Welcome to Art 100, Looking at Art. I'm Kirsten Ellsworth. I'll be your instructor this afternoon. For more information, more ideas, more conversation about the history of art. And as always, this is much more exciting if you text in or phone in your comments, your observations, questions. Our phone number is 800-339-1193. And then you can also text in to askdhtv@gmail.com. Let's get started. Today we are going to continue talking about arts across time and begin with the Parthenon in Greece. We're starting with architecture today, and the Parthenon represents so much: technological innovation, spirituality, nationalism, in just this one building, this one temple built on the top of a hill known as the Acropolis. We have what sets a standard in Western civilization of bringing the state, the religion, and the power of the nation together in a single building. While we're looking at this, you might be thinking of the U.S. Capitol, for example, because Washington, D.C. is modeled largely on the buildings from the ancient Greeks. Because the Greeks give us these wonderful monuments of civic power and pride. So as we're looking at the Parthenon, you have to put your imagination to work. This was not pale white when it was built. The Parthenon was painted in bright colors. I know you don't believe me right now, but yes, the Greek sculptures and the Parthenon, they were painted in bright reds and blues. What we see now, the pure appearances of marble, etc., are not the way the buildings were originally intended. And this was a temple to Athena, who was the patron goddess of the city of Athens and a goddess of knowledge. And the Parthenon's history is really magnificent. From its beginnings, the architects, and we have the names of the architects. This is a bit new for us because we've been looking at older arts and we don't have artists' names. Kallikrates and Ichthynos were the architectural firm who built the Parthenon. And the building, look at these marvelous details. They structured those columns so that the building looked taller than it really was. There's some trickery here. And over time, the Parthenon first was dedicated to Greek society and religion, but then the Christians came here. Muslims have been here, and the building has this amazing history of being taken over by different religions. Because it sits at the top of a hill, it was intended to be a beacon for people approaching Greece and the city of Athens, and a statement of power. And what I would like to do to sort of give you a visual feast to convey these ideas is to look at a clip which is an animated view of the history of this magnificent building, the Parthenon. So let's watch the short video clip on the history of the Parthenon.
Thank you.
That is pretty amazing work. I think just to respect the animation that went into, on the effects that went into making that, telling you the history, and then think about that short piece. You see the cross rises on the pediment of the Parthenon as the Franks, an ancient European tribe, take over. So that video shows you the building was just appropriated when the Christians came through. And then you see the Turkish invasion. And the building, there's actually, as they showed, there is a modification to make the Parthenon turn into a mosque. It's a wonderful way to tell a story, that piece that we just watched, in these little chunks with a bit of humor, right? Because you do see, well, I don't know what your sense of humor is, but to see someone fall off the building, one of the things I love about that video is that it shows you the scale of things. Those are ordinary-sized men chiseling away up there. They look like ants working in that piece. They're shown as ants working on the top of, or on the facade of the building, and they're making the sculptures that are so famously part of the Parthenon. So the scale of the human is this, the scale of the gods is this, right? And that says a lot about the Greek origin of the building. With that said, in the video we just saw, there was a nice close-up of, and notice the green colors, I hope, and the reds. There was a nice close-up of this part of the building we call the pediment and the sculptural programs that were placed up there. Let's look at the three goddesses who came down off of the east pediment of the Parthenon. These were, and the video really helped you get the context, the three goddesses. I want to point out a few things. Do you see how they form a shape which is architectural shape that would be like half of a pyramid, and that in this way they fit into one side of the top of the Parthenon east pediment. So the sculptors had to render their bodies in such a way that the bodies looked natural and yet it would fit into the architecture. That is hard. Looking at these women, they're large, they're goddesses. The drapery, everything you're seeing, the clothing, it's all marble, everyone. But the technical knowledge of the material marble was so impressive during this period with the Greeks. I feel that you think those might just be draperies that were placed on a sculpture. The whole thing is carved of marble. And the three goddesses, why are they not on the Parthenon anymore? Why are they not there? Well, the three goddess sculptures and others over time were stolen off of the Parthenon. And in one of the more infamous cases, an English gentleman, Lord Elgin, was hacked off, had removed these kinds of works, and he took them back to England and he kept them in his apartment, very nice flat. And only when Lord Elgin, this is in the 19th century, only when he was divorcing and there was going to be an argument about ownership of these works, did he give them to the newly forming British Museum of Art, where you can see some of these works. So they are no longer in Greece, which raises problems. I would like to hear from you. How do you feel about that story of the removal of the marbles from the Parthenon, the sculptures? Let me know. What are your feelings about taking this art object away from the country of origin and keeping it somewhere else? And Katie is asking a question. What happened, in addition, what happened to the original color of the Parthenon? Over time, those colors wore off. And if you've ever tried to paint marble, it's not an easy thing to do. And they were not replaced. The original colors were not replaced. And even in older times, this was viewed as a ruin, right? Excellent question, Katie. Now, the treatment of the body that you see in our three goddesses from the Parthenon, they are animated figures, they're realistic figures, they're casual poses. In the Hellenistic period, which is the last period of Greek art that we're going to talk about, this ability to take and to make a sculpture look so realistic and exhibit so much movement kind of came to a high point with a work such as the Venus de Milo. The Venus de Milo is one of the most famous works of Greek sculpture. And I like to always say, as reverent as we want to be, here we are, we're before Venus right now. You know, the goddess of love and beauty. She's in our presence. She's tall. She's powerful pose. But everyone, that drape is looking to me like it's a little bit below the waist. And it looks like it might fall off. If you're sticking with me on this one, in the Hellenistic period, there was more of a soap opera context, I guess you would say, and some of the stories about the gods and goddesses, which often mirrored the stories and the problems of humanity, got a little racy. And in the context of Greek art, Venus de Milo has a bit of a racy cast to her. Sometimes scholars look at the Hellenistic period and see a decline of idealism and a decline of everything, and that happens when we're able to look back at things. So Venus may not be as pure as you might think, even though we've got marble, and look at the back. Very interesting. That hairstyle, sort of a bun, you know, becomes what we call classic hairstyle. And yet, if you look again, that the at the back of Venus, the cloth is coming down a bit lower than need be, I suppose you could say. So there is a bit of maybe eroticism in this work. And there was a poem that was connected to the sculpture, which talked about certain parts of Venus's body and how attractive they were. So why are her arms missing? Well, over time, things like noses and arms do tend to fall off of sculptures. What was she holding? I bet some of you could help us here. What might Venus have held in those arms? What might she have held in her arms? Possibly the knee that's kind of bent. She might have had a shield there. But there's probably something else she would have been holding in her arm. And you notice she has a bit of a detached look. She is the goddess of beauty, everyone, so possibly a mirror, vanity, might have been one of her attributes. And Brandon's giving a nice reply to our question. Should a work such as this be returned to Greece, right? And Brandon is saying, yes, the sculptures, Parthenon, what we've been looking at, should be returned to Greece and possibly placed in a Greek museum since they were stolen from the Greeks. You know, Brandon and the rest of viewers, during the Olympics, there was a hope that in sort of a dramatic nationalist or pan-nationalist mood, I guess you could say, that these works, as Brandon is saying, would be returned to Greece, and they were not. There's a lot of money to be had in having museums having people come see the work. So I'm hearing from Brandon. Does anyone have a different point of view? Let's hear it. Do you think that the work should remain in, let's say, a European museum? The Greeks. There is an expression, it's kind of a cliche, but I think it holds some truth, that although the Romans conquered the Greeks, Greek art conquered the Romans, okay? We are going to talk about Rome now. And the Romans really loved the Greek arts. They adopted the Greek pantheon of gods and goddesses and just changed the names and added two, three new ones. But they emulated the Greek arts, and I hope you can see why. They loved the grandeur, they loved the sophistication, and so many times the Romans either copied Greek arts or built things in ways that looked Greek. And Rome, the empire, were in the dates of 510 BCE to 500 AD or CE. This is a long time. As you know, the Roman Empire is stretched far across Europe and into North Africa, and it shouldn't surprise you that the Romans built a lot of architecture, lots of roads, lots of aqueducts to keep that empire running. And something that the Romans respected that we're not going to see in Greek arts is age. Let's look at the double portrait that we have to look at today. The double portrait, if we look, take a closer look at this, this is a couple, a married couple, and what a mark of tenderness. Her arm is on his shoulder, right? But the age is shown. There's no hiding the age. He's got wrinkles on his face, wrinkles on his forehead. We all get this. And this tendency in Roman art to show really naturalistic portraits and to show age, it says something a little different about Roman culture in that the respect of the elder was strong. Not to say that wasn't the case with the Greeks, but the Greeks in their arts really promoted body beautiful youth culture. And even the woman here, if you look at this, you could consider she's about the same height, possibly on a more equal level with her husband. And the Roman matron was an important gender type. This was a middle-aged woman who, you know, ran the household, organized the shopping. If it was another upper-class person such as these, this woman, she would be supervising a household and servants. And this was heavily valued in the literature and in the arts, this type of woman. You're not going to find in Rome so much the pretty younger goddess type. It's an older woman. Now, the Romans adopted Greek gods and goddesses, and then they also had some very interesting religious cults. Let's look at the wall painting from the Villa of the Mysteries. The name alone should get you interested. The Villa of the Mysteries wall painting. Now, I want to know, will you let me know if you've been to the Getty Villa and you're watching right now, and what you liked at the Getty Villa? Have you been to the Getty Villa? What did you like about it? Phone us, text in. I'm asking this question because I'm curious, and I also hope someone will talk to us about their trip to the Getty Villa. And in addition, the Getty Villa has some reproductions of Roman wall paintings that you really, if you like what we're going to talk about, you want to make a trip, and you're local, you want to make a trip up there. So let me know if you've been to the villa, what you liked. And let's talk about this piece from the Villa of the Mysteries. Pompeii, does that ring a bell with anyone? What happened in Pompeii that in 79 CE or AD, Mount Vesuvius erupts, right? And buried the towns of Pompeii and Herculaneum and some other areas. But the lava flow acted like a preservative. So we have in the 1700s these excavations, and we find things like our wall painting. This wall painting shows the cult rituals of Dionysus. Now, if you study these images, they are confusing and esoteric, meaning you can't really tell what's going on. And that's on purpose, or that's intentional, because the cult rituals were secretive. And Dionysus, what was Dionysus the god of? Will someone help us out? What was Dionysus in charge of? Whatever that was, I want to hear from someone. Dionysus certainly had attracted female followers. Let's put it that way. And a lot of the people involved in the cult of Dionysus were women. So our wall painting does feature women. There's also a depiction of Dionysus. Beyond that, it's kind of hard to understand the rituals, but they were important enough to line the walls of this special Villa of the Mysteries. And that red, everyone, is not a new red. That's the red the Romans loved. Okay, they loved that color. The Romans built sports arenas. They built the first known sports arenas, or the biggest ones we know about. And what you see behind me is Dionysus in this wall painting. I still want to know Dionysus, what was he in charge of? I don't want to answer. I want someone to help us out here. So the Romans built for spectator sports. Let's look at the Colosseum. And while we're thinking about the Colosseum, the Greeks also loved sports. They initiated the Olympics. But there's a difference. The Olympics, there's a lot in the history of the Olympics, a lot of individual sport and a lot of testing of the individual, a little bit elevated. Oh no, not for the Romans. The Romans would have built the casinos that we have in our state of California, for example, because these are entertainments that are gladiator contests, fighting animals. There's nothing too elevated about these sports. And in fact, the Romans took this bloodthirst to pretty awful levels by persecuting religious minorities and putting killing people on display. You're looking right now at the bottom level of the Colosseum, which is where they kept animals that they would release for these kind of blood sports. And then they also kept people, very awful. And then those contests ended in the death of the person. So people paid to see this kind of entertainment. This seated 50,000 spectators. That's like a modern day stadium. And there were different levels, and in the very expensive, what you might call skyboxes today, they had marble seats. So much like we have today, you pay, you know, different prices for the benefit of sitting in a different place at the stadium. They could also have mock sea battles at the Colosseum because they could flood it and put ships in here. As always, arts and architectures of a culture tell you something about the interests of the culture. And this is pretty violent. And what else to say, I don't know. I haven't heard about Dionysus, but I'll just remind you, Dionysus is the god of wine. He usually has grapes around his head, or grape leaves. And the god of, I call him the god of wine, women, and song. He was, you know, people would get drunk and then they would follow Dionysus. He was also associated with the theater because the theater is a transformation. When you sit down before a play, you kind of close your eyes, and when the play starts, you believe it's real. And that's what Dionysus was about. As we are thinking about the Romans, something else has been happening. And this is during the reign of Emperor Augustus in Rome, a person who becomes known as historical Jesus is born in Bethlehem. And this event is going to change a lot of things. And eventually Christianity will extend over the Roman Empire. But as the religion began, it was there were persecutions, and Christ was crucified by the Romans. If you're familiar with these traditions and these stories from Christianity, Constantine the Great. We have a large sculpture of Constantine to look at. It's almost 9 feet high. Constantine the Great, a marble portrait bust. Constantine the Great was the Roman emperor who in 1313 allowed Christians to worship freely. And Constantine the Great has, you know, an important role here in history. He converted to Christianity, but Constantine converted to a lot of different religions when he was emperor. In some cases, we can't judge a person's, is that a true conversion or not, but sometimes it was expedient for him. But it is, Constantine's mother was Christian. So there may be something that led him, and he also had a vision that led him to convert to Christianity. So here's a question for you. Your job is, or you're an artist and you're asked to design artworks and buildings that show a new religion. What are you going to do? How are you going to visualize the new religion? And the earliest Christian arts tend to borrow from the Greeks and the Romans. So, it shouldn't really surprise you when you consider that early arts, the figure of Christ might look like Zeus, for example. And it's going to change And we're going to talk about these changes really for the rest of the afternoon. We're going to look at the way Christian arts evolve. But first, let's take a 5-minute break and get resituated to start thinking about Christianity in the arts. So let's take a 5-minute break.
You are watching DHTV, the television program service of California State University, Dominguez Hills.
We're passing out information for all the parents that come in, so we're letting them know where the workshops are, what time, and what to find inside the gym. Junior at Cal State University, Dominguez Hills. These are the schools I want to apply to.
So it's really, really exciting that we are trying to increase like the amount of students that go into college.
I'm Carla Carlini, President and General Manager here at LA 36. I'd like to take a moment to thank you for watching our channel and to tell you some important information that will be affecting some Time Warner customers in the city of Los Angeles. Beginning October 8th, if you do not have a cable box, digital adapter, or cable card, you will not be able to see LA 36 and some other channels like this one. You'll need to contact Time Warner to get a free digital adapter. Here's how. You can call 855-286-1736 or go online to twc.com/digital adapter. It's that easy to continue seeing the programming you love, Los Angeles. From the stunning performances at the Ford Theater, to the thought-provoking speakers at the Los Angeles World Affairs Council, to the revealing political discussions from LMU, and all the educational programming from our partners at schools like Cal State Dominguez Hills and USC. So contact Time Warner today for your free digital adapter. You won't want to miss 1 minute of LA 36, your connection to your community. Thank you for your support. We appreciate you watching.
Enrich your life. Increase your earning potential. Cal State Dominguez Hills offers a master's degree in the humanities. With a focus on the cities of the world, this master's degree can be earned in as little as 5 semesters. Evening classes are available for your convenience. Why wait? Call 310-243-3636. That's 310-243-3636.
Thank you.
You're watching DHTV, the broadcast program service of California State University, Dominguez Hills.
Welcome back to Art 100, Looking at Art. I'm Kirsten Ellsworth here with you, and I asked you a question before we closed, and that question was, what would you do? You're the artist, you're the designer, you're the architect. What are you going to do to show a new religion? And this religion is Christianity. There are many answers, and as always, we only have time to touch on a few. But one of the things I hope popped into your mind while you were taking the break was, well, you know, we have to have churches, right? Because Christianity has churches. And the earliest Christian churches that Constantine supervised, remember Emperor Constantine? Those churches were like a large assembly hall. If you looked at them now, they don't have a cross form. They look like an auditorium because the Romans built auditoriums, so it made sense to them. Well, a worship area for the new church should look like an auditorium. And then time passes a little bit, and we enter into the early Middle Ages. And sometimes this used to be called the Dark Ages, but I would caution you not to use that term. Why? Because Dark Ages, as indicates, basically the lights are off. There's no intellectual growth, that people were sort of behind. This is the medieval period we're speaking of now. We've made a jump. The early Middle Ages, the medieval period, is not a time where people were suddenly frozen intellectually. You might look back and say, well, there were some beliefs that science has replaced. But let's call it the early Middle Ages, or the early medieval period, rather than the Dark Ages. So what happens, these early churches, they deviate a bit from Constantine's big auditoriums, and what we get instead are buildings that still have a dome and have this kind of shape, but they are often located away from the cities. Sometimes we get monasteries, right? And then most of these early Christian churches are dedicated to a relic. And I'm wondering if anyone can help us out here with what a relic is. In early Christianity, I want to hear from you. I'll just start, and if someone can help me out. In early Christianity, there was a lot of veneration of some things called relics. And relics could be a piece of the Virgin Mary's cloak, right? Or a bone from St. Peter. The idea here, skeptics among us are saying, what is she talking about? The idea was that faith is the missing link here. Someone might believe that, and it could be true, right? It's all dependent upon the person here, that something they had been touched by the Virgin Mary. And then a church would acquire the relic and build a place, a reliquary. A reliquary is a box or a church or a structure to hold this precious relic. And so what I want to talk to you about now is the very famous Saint Faith, also called Sainte-Foy in Conques, France. This is an early medieval or early Middle Ages church, and it housed a relic associated with Saint Faith. In English, we would call this Saint Faith. Saint Faith was a little girl, and as the story went, this little girl was persecuted for believing in Christianity, so she became a martyr. And then the whole building is built to house the relic and to sort of honor her story, and then it's also one of our earliest Christian churches. And I want to show you a video about this location. And I want you to watch as closely as you can and enjoy, because there's no speaking here. It's rather meditative. And I want you to look at the top of the capitals. This is the part on the top of the columns. And look at how plain things are. Because we are now in the early building of Christianity in the early Middle Ages. Those of you who like Gothic arts, etc., know what's coming next. Tons of decoration. But let's spend some time with an earlier structure. So make sure you're watching for the plainness. The walls look heavy. Sometimes we could call that Roman influence. Remember, the Romans loved their round arches and their thick walls. And we can often call these early medieval, in fact, churches such as the one we're going to look at, Romanesque, Roman in style. So let's enjoy this silent video of Sainte-Foy, also known as Saint Faith. That last shot kind of always gets to me, those faces. I hope you enjoyed, by the way, just sort of a solitary view of that, just sort of experienced in silence. But something to think about, in the earlier parts of Christianity, certain stories about heaven and hell and the last judgment were very popular. And so those faces and some of the images you saw on that structure were associated with things, beliefs of things that might happen to you if you disobeyed. I mean, this in the Middle Ages or medieval period, we definitely have a fear element of Christianity that's emphasized. Now, I would like to show you I mentioned to you that the structure we just looked at, Saint Faith, was the martyr. Let's look at the reliquary statue of Saint Faith. This is page 10. Page 10, the reliquary statue of Saint Faith. So when you see this inside, and we'd never be allowed to look inside, we would find a relic, but always the relic. Think of the church we just looked at as a reliquary, a container, and then we can have even small, more exquisite gold containers. And while we're waiting for that image, I wanted to mention to you that a few things about the medieval period that we have jumped to. There is a preoccupation with building the buildings for the Christian religion. And there are other objects that you should be familiar with, manuscripts, illustrated manuscripts. This is before Xerox, everyone. So here we would have monks copying laboriously, word for word, in pen and ink, the words of a part of the Bible. And then an artist, perhaps a monk, illustrating that with a beautiful illumination. So other objects from this time, we also have a lot of tapestries from the Middle Ages, and some of them describe religious scenes, but a lot of them also include some of those wonderful animals like unicorns. Unicorns from the Middle Ages are, as the story goes, it's a young lady, only a young lady, a young virgin actually, can tame the unicorn, the mythical beast, right? I would ask anyone who's seen a unicorn to text or phone in. That would be interesting. But the unicorn, a magical animal. So during the Middle Ages, not everything is Christian, a Christian context, but it is strong in Europe. And in addition to those kinds of art objects, let's ask, who are the people of Europe that we associate with the Middle Ages or the medieval period? Well, these are the early European tribes. So we have the Franks, we have the Goths, the Visigoths, Germany, we have the Scandinavian tribes, and you have to sort of rethink Europe and understand that Europe is being built at this time in the early Middle Ages. Christianity, the kings and other leaders are converting to Christianity, and they are sponsoring the construction of many of these cathedrals and also these book arts, and all they are the patrons for lots of royal courts for these early Christian arts. And yet monks are producing a lot of the art. And then you have whole classes of artisans who can build the cathedrals, make the stained glass, etc. So I just wanted to give you a descriptive sort of portrait of, or a context for this period. And as you're kind of digesting that and trying to think of Europe as an area covered with tribes, and those of you who might be of Irish descent, of course, we can't leave off Ireland and the Celtic influence in some of these arts. In fact, some of our first manuscripts come not from England, but Ireland. And I think we should take another 5-minute break, and then we will move on and talk about the Gothic part of this story. So let's take a 5-minute break.
You are watching DHTV, the television program service of California State University, Dominguez Hills.
Passing out information for all the parents that come in, so we're letting them know where the workshops are, what time, and what to find inside the gym.
I'm Carla Carlini, President and General Manager here at LA36. I'd like to take a moment to thank you for watching our channel and to tell you some important information that will be affecting some Time Warner customers in the city of Los Angeles. Beginning October 8th, if you do not have a cable box, digital adapter, or cable card, you will not be able to see LA36 and some other channels like this one. You'll need to contact Time Warner to get a free digital adapter. Here's how. You can call 855-286-1736 or go online to twc.com/digital adapter. It's that easy to continue seeing the programming you love, Los Angeles. From the stunning performances at the Ford Theater, to the thought-provoking speakers at the Los Angeles World Affairs Council, to the revealing political discussions from LMU, and all the educational programming from our partners at schools like Cal State Dominguez Hills and USC. So contact Time Warner today for your free digital adapter. You won't want to miss 1 minute of LA36. Your connection to your community. Thank you for your support. We appreciate you watching.
Enrich your life. Increase your earning potential. Cal State Dominguez Hills offers a master's degree in the humanities. With a focus on the cities of the world, this master's degree can be earned in as little as 5 semesters. Evening classes are available for your convenience. Why wait? Call 310-243-3636. That's 310-243-3636.
You're watching DHTV, the broadcast program service of California State University, Dominguez Hills.
Welcome back to R100, Looking at Art. I'm Kirsten Ellsworth, and we are amidst a conversation about the early Middle Ages and the role of Christianity in the arts. And I want to hear from you. So as always, please phone in or text in your observations, comments, questions. That's 800-339-1193. And then our texting address is askdhtv@gmail.com. We just watched this video of one of the Romanesque churches, and that Saint Foy has, or Saint Faith, has a relic in it. And people made pilgrimages to see that relic. And here you have a very nice overview. Looking down, you can see that this is an isolated area. And many times, churches, monasteries would crop up on these lands away from the cities. That's not going to be the case with Gothic, but at this time, yes. And let's look at the reliquary statue that holds that relic of Saint Faith. So let's look at the reliquary statue from the late 10th to early 11th centuries. Here we are. And inside we have a relic associated with Saint Faith. As I mentioned to you, we don't get to touch that or see that as members of, let's say, this congregation, and look at the expense. Now, this is very characteristic of the medieval arts of Christianity. Expensive. Expensive, lots of jewels, gold. And this relic would have been brought out at certain times during the year and shown to the congregation. Very exquisite. If you like luxury in your arts, this is a good period for you. Another type of artwork from the medieval period is the tapestry. Tapestry is an English word for what Americans tend to call embroidery. And you are looking at just one tiny piece of the Bayeux tapestry. Now, this tapestry comes from about 1073 to 1088. And maybe while we take this next, we have to take a 5-minute break again. Please be patient, bear with us. I would like everyone watching to get out on Google and look at the full view of the Bayeux tapestry. Okay, so that's your project, and we are going to take, I'm sorry, we're not going to take another break, but you can still do that project. You can still get out on Google and get the full view here, because the point being that what you're looking at is a little part of a tapestry that's over 200 feet long, okay? 200 feet long, 20 inches high, a massive storytelling, right? And this tells this tapestry, dutifully embroidered by anonymous, likely women, we don't have their names, tells the story of the conquest of England by William of Normandy in 1066. There are 72 separate episodes. There are thousands of figures and letters. And to digest this in one sample is never going to cut it. But you can see the military garb, the animals, the mystical, magical, medieval animals show up, those griffins and things like that. Historians can study this to see the military practices of the time, to look at what people were wearing. It's amazing. And it's interesting because it's not a single oil painting, anything like that. It's a long tapestry. Now, the Gothic period where we are moving now, 1200 to 1400s, the Gothic period, the strong point here for us is the cathedral. And as a reminder, someone is telling us that, just reminding us when we were talking about relics, a relic is an object with some sort of underlying religious significance. That is a good definition to keep in mind, because the Gothic cathedrals also housed relics. And this person is mentioning to us the Shroud of Turin. That's a very interesting relic to bring up. And there's controversy as to whether that is a shroud that was worn by Jesus. And within Gothic cathedrals in Chartres, it is believed that a shroud, a part of the cloak worn by the Virgin, is the relic. So thank you for reminding us the importance of relics. The Gothic period is, the cathedrals we're going to talk about were built in France. And the cathedrals are dependent upon pointed arches and vaulted ceilings and other architectural innovation that lets these things get so tall, for lack of better words. And as you're looking at these wonderful images we have of different cathedrals, please notice some new things. Rose window. The large window that's round that you see is called a rose window, and it would be filled with colored stained glass, a very important part of the Gothic period is the colored stained glass. Oh, look at that. That's a rose window. And then the forms beneath it that look sort of like fingers, those are called lancets. And in each lancet, you would have a personage from the Bible. Now, what is the function of a stained glass window? I want to ask this question to our viewers. What is the function of a stained glass window? I'm going to wait and hear from you. And as you're looking at this image, please note that little shape, the fleur-de-lis in the corner, In each corner of that shot, we have that symbol. That is the symbol of the King of France. So built right into the iconography of these cathedrals are the symbolisms of the royalty, because the royal religion and the king are the same. It's the same. The king is believed to be ordained by God. But I still want to hear, what was the purpose of these windows? What was the purpose of the windows? And look at these details. I'll show you. Here we have a nice window, just an arrangement of the fleur-de-lis, or symbol of the king. And sometimes we would have panels within these windows that showed the patrons who helped pay for the cathedrals. Promotional windows, you might call them, of the Gothic period. And sometimes the local brewmeister gave a lot of money, because he probably made a lot of money, and would be symbolized in the cathedral. So there are some secular images in here as well. Now, let's look at the floor plan for Chartres. And those of you who are interested in architecture, a floor plan, or maybe one of our cutaway views, a diagram to help us see how the building functions. If we can look at one of those, we're on page 11. Ah, fantastic. Look at this. The church looks like a cross. We have reached that time in the Christian arts where the cruciform shape, which you're looking at here, becomes dominant. And looking at this plan, which is actually of an older structure, I just would like to point out, anything you see at the end here is a radiating, these are radiating chapels, and sometimes families would sponsor those areas of these, of Christian churches in general. Now, let's look at the other images we have of Chartres Cathedral, and remember that the Gothic cathedral was a really important part of the community, but there was resistance to the building of these cathedrals. They were expensive. How did the king get the money to build these? Taxation, right? And it took years to build them. And what you're looking at, and anytime you're looking at a photograph, or if you have the privilege of seeing one of these in person, you're looking at years of work. Sometimes building campaigns worked, sometimes time ran out, money ran out. And local citizens would become angry because around the building there were workers who were itinerant workers who camped out and did the sculpture and did the glass and everything associated with these wonderful cathedrals. So the Gothic period, there's a lot of what's often called soaring verticality here. Up to the heavens, up to the heavens. This is a time where people are speaking of building a city is equivalent to building the new Jerusalem. Heavenly city is on earth. You might be wondering, well, is this excessive? Is it too expensive? Is it detracting from the message of Christianity? Those questions were asked. There were critics of the cathedrals who thought that it was a distraction from the religious message, that they were too luxurious. And if you're interested in these tales and these stories, you want to keep reading about the Gothic period, because there were heated debates about this. And it will lead to some changes in making art, right? Now, the Gothic period is our last conversation here before we reach the Renaissance. And we're going to move on to the Renaissance. There's never enough time to talk about the Renaissance. And I have a question. There are many questions, right? But one of the questions to think about for the Renaissance is going to be about perspective, because as you are learning, the use of perspective really takes off in interesting ways in the Renaissance. People tend to love the Renaissance period because of many things, one of them being the use of perspective. And things to think about for the Renaissance. Renaissance art, if you're thinking of the map of Europe at the time or anything like this, Renaissance means rebirth. The Renaissance is a rebirth. What is it a rebirth of? The Renaissance takes place in Italy, And at this time, Italy is a collection of city-states with a lot of money in some cases, and a nouveau riche, and some powerful cultural and capital brokers. And the Catholic Church becomes a very wealthy, still is, institution collecting and patronizing the arts. And the Italians have been living, everyone, with those wonderful ruins from Rome. And factors come together, a renewed interest in the Greco-Roman heritage, some new ideas about humans being at the center of things, the rise of science. Artists become celebrities at this time. You can name some of them right now. You have wealth supporting the arts, and you have a desire, a very conscious desire to say, this is a renaissance. This is a rebirth of a classical civilization. But we're now talking about, let's say, 1400 to 1500 in Italy. So these are some considerations when you're thinking about the story of the Renaissance. And early Renaissance art, we're going to talk about early Renaissance art, the High Renaissance. We'll be looking at, as much as we can in a short amount of time, some very famous works. And you might be asking yourself, why do I know these works of art? Because the Renaissance is, many art historians see it as such an achievement that it has been studied quite a bit. Let's start our story with the Lady and the Unicorn. Let's look at the Lady and the Unicorn. Now, this is from the late 15th century. It's another one of these tapestries. And it's done during the 15th century. It's the time of the Renaissance in Italy. But everyone, we're still a bit in the Gothic here. And here's a nice case study sort of to show how we leave the Gothic and we come to the Renaissance. For one thing, the Lady and the Unicorn, as I mentioned to you before, is one of those stories that was beloved in the medieval period. It's magical. That young woman is a beautiful lady who has tamed the unicorn. He's right at her side. And that is a medieval legend. In addition, those other animals are holding heralds, family crests, let's say. And those animals represent her suitors, probably, the lion being one of them, okay? One of the people wanting to be a suitor for the lady who tames the unicorn. It's rather flat representation. And in the Renaissance, here's what's going to be different. The stories are more about Greco-Roman myths. Flatness is replaced in the Renaissance with a deeper sense of a perspective. And we're not going to find, you know, the preferred method of art making in the Renaissance is oil painting eventually. And then we have frescoes. So we have differences from the Lady and the Unicorn to think about. Now, maybe what we could do at this point is move to a video that will introduce us to fresco painting and the Renaissance, because fresco painting is very important when studying Renaissance art. And when we watch this video, we're going to be looking at Masaccio, the work of the Renaissance artist Masaccio, who was really well known for his fresco technique. And I want to point out a few things to watch for in our video. Masaccio's subject matter is Christian. It's a Trinity portrait, the Virgin, St. John the Evangelist, and donors. The donors appear right in the work, right alongside or beneath the Virgin. The donors are the ones who contributed to make, you know, to pay the artist to make the fresco. As you watch this video, look at how Masaccio is using these lines, use of lines, to achieve this deep perspective associated with the Renaissance. And look at how he likes the pyramid composition. We talked about this many times ago, A pyramid is usually used to show the Virgin. It's a stable form. And I want you also, as you're watching this video, to remember that frescoes have to be built into the wall. So usually a fresco was rendered in an architectural setting. You have to have a coat, many steps to make a fresco. You have to have a sketch. That was called a cartoon. Yes, that's where the word cartoon comes from. You had to have a cartoon or a sketch. You had to place that paper sketch on the wall where you wanted your fresco and take a little instrument and make holes. Remove the paper, or make holes, put some chalk along them, remove the paper so you had little chalk dots to show you what you were doing. Then you had to prepare plaster. Then you had to prepare paint. And when making a fresco, please, when you're watching this video, think about how Masaccio had not the chance to make a lot of mistakes. Because once the fresco pigment is applied to the plaster, everything hardens and you are left with one choice, really, if you make a mistake, and that is to dig out and start again. So may we see the video piece we have on Masaccio's Trinity with the Virgin, a Renaissance fresco painting.
Utilize Brunelleschi's theories of perspective and apply them with astonishing effect was Masaccio. On a wall in a church in Florence, Masaccio created a three-dimensional illusion unlike any the world had ever seen. This extraordinary work, called the Trinity, finished about 1427, was the first known painting to demonstrate true linear perspective. For the people of Masaccio's day, it was as if the artist had dissolved the wall and created a new room. Yet, it was still a painting, just an illusion. Utilizing the power of the computer and digital technology, we can explore this imaginary space. Masaccio used perspective to create a space so consistent that we can actually enter the room. The computer even lets us rotate the room to look at the coffered inside of the vault from directly below. The images of Christ and the other figures become flat without sufficient visual information to create fully three-dimensional forms. Assuming that the coffers are square, the room itself becomes a rectangle, as we can see when we look at it from above. We can also view the room from the side. The black patches represent the parts of the ceiling that are covered by the architectural capitals that Masaccio painted in the foreground. The powerful effect of this illusion, painted by a young artist only in his 20s, is astonishing. Scaffolding erected for restoration of the Trinity provides us with the opportunity to examine the fresco at close range. The cleaning of the painting now completed, conservators fill in missing areas of the fresco with water-soluble paint, which can be removed at any time. Masaccio's original work is never touched. Strong raking lights help to highlight the surface of the plaster, enabling us to explore details not visible from the floor of the church below, and revealing Masaccio's technique. His use of perspective and geometry is extraordinary. All elements of the architecture grow out of his perspective design. Masaccio constructed the curves of the vaulted ceiling by stretching a length of string from a nail set in the wall and using a stylus to score the arcs into the wet plaster. He also incised lines to determine the perspective scheme for the work. This line, still visible, leads from the vanishing point below. To create straight lines such as these, Masaccio snapped a tautly stretched string into the wet plaster. You can still see the twisted texture of the string, preserved in the plaster for nearly 600 years.
Okay, number one, do you feel that you would be nervous? Remember the woman there who was taking her paint set to fill in things? I would be nervous if that was my job, but somebody has to do it, right? And what do you think? Those strings, he actually laid down pieces of string to help him, you know, get his perspective. That's amazing, right? And the string, as this video shows so well, you can tell it's his cheat sheet, so to speak. Did that video help you see something about technique, perspective, fresco? I hope so. And I also want you to think about the content. That video was depicting the Virgin, and Katie is giving us a really good comment about these Christian subjects. Katie Gilliam tells us, I'm afraid I can't read all of Katie's comment, but thank you. One of the primary purposes of stained glass, she's answering the stained glass question, was to tell biblical stories, and that continues in the Renaissance into frescoes as well. Yes, so these decorations and these art forms that become important in Christianity, such as the stained glass and the Bible and the fresco, are definitely there to tell Bible stories, largely in addition to what Katie's saying, because people could not read. The numbers of people who could read were nothing like they are in our time. And Seth adds another wonderful point. He's also speaking to our stained glass window question, but I'm going to add, I think your question will work just well, very well with Masaccio's fresco. Purpose, stained glass windows, to help light the building and the room. Yes, and also to add bright, colorful art. You will see, as you just saw in our video about Masaccio, bright colors. Bright colors, it's decorative. There are aesthetics at play here. So, excellent comments about our arts for today. Now, in addition to fresco, in the Renaissance, we have a lot of sculpture. And let's look at Donatello's St. Mark. Donatello's St. Mark. This Donatello was a very famous sculptor from the Renaissance. And you have a lot of Renaissance tendencies to take into account when looking at this. And I'm wondering, did anyone think that's Greek? You're not off base. Remember, the Renaissance is a rebirth of interest in the Greco-Roman world. So don't be fooled. There are some things we can talk about that help you say, okay, no, this is a Renaissance work of art, not a Greco-Roman. But let's start by looking at early Renaissance tendencies. The body is a little different at this point. If we look at this detail, for example, of Saint Mark, we see that there's a lot of flexibility in that body, a lot of movement. And the Renaissance artists appear to have used this technique where they made a clay model of the body and then they draped soaked linens to create the garments. But the garments hang a little differently than those, say, on the Venus de Milo from Greece. These garments, the body has more power here, and the garments kind of hang on the body, right? Also, this work, although it is placed, as you can see, in a niche environment, these sculptures can stand independently, and that's a little bit different than things we have seen. The clothing, as I mentioned to you, the clothing responds to the body beneath the body. And Donatello was only 25 years old when he made this, or he started this project. We have a lot of young artists in the Renaissance, sort of the young Turks of the Renaissance, or the young guns of the Renaissance. Now, let's move in yet another different direction, and let's look at Lorenzo Ghiberti's The Story of Jacob and Esau. The Story of Jacob and Esau. This is From the Gates of Paradise. because we need to talk a bit more about perspective. Something that happened in the Renaissance in 1425, a system of linear perspective was published. That's your key. Perspective has been understood since time began. People worked in perspective. During the Renaissance, models and rules for perspective were published and therefore became a rule. And that's the difference. And many types of perspectival systems. So when you're looking at something such as what we have right now, Lorenzo Ghiberti's work From the Gates of Paradise, cast in bronze, look at how this, just this one detail showing three women, some of the women's backs are to us. The women are in a conversation. There's a lot of depth here. And these are the qualities of perspective that are favored in the Renaissance and that people like Leon Alberti publish as rules. Here's another here's another image. And just, I will point out to you, look at, in the Renaissance, there is an effortlessness with bodies. Look how this guy's feet are crossed. That's probably how you've stood, I'm sure, this way in your life. And look at these three women. We looked at three Greek women, but these three women, this is a very kind of intimate conversation, intimate poses. Look at the nice twist in the body. This is what distinguishes the Renaissance treatment of the body from, say, that of the ancient Greeks. And there is an interest in positioning things in a normal setting. There's a little dog there in the corner, a little bit more informal. And this is just another element or another consideration for why the Renaissance is valued so highly by art historians. Let's look next. Let's skip the Masaccio because we watched a video about Masaccio. And let's move to page four. Let's move to page four and look at The Birth of Venus by Botticelli. Okay, The Birth of Venus by Botticelli, 1480. This is one of the most famous works from the Renaissance coming up here. And The Birth of Venus tells us of something about the Renaissance love for the Roman and Greek myths. As I promised you, it's not unicorns for the Renaissance. It's the goddesses, it's the Greek stuff. The Venus, the birth of Venus, as the story goes, she was just born of the sea and she just gracefully came in on a clamshell and casually stepped out on the beach, right? This painting, which I think is beloved by many people, I look at the face. I hate to even mark on something like this because it's just so spectacular, but I look at her face and I see a Renaissance woman's face and I see Renaissance hairstyle, the long hair. I look over here at one of the, I believe this is Pomona, helping, you know, Venus is so beautiful that she has to be covered. Look at that face. That is not the face of a Greek sculpture. That's a Renaissance face. And that's a model. She must be a model Botticelli liked. And her hair is the style. Something to think about with Renaissance art. When figures are clothed, they're clothed in the clothing of the time. So if we look again at the previous image, we see that the figure is wearing, on the right, she's wearing a kind of an empire-waisted gown, typical of the Renaissance. We have a personification here. What's a personification? I'm going to tell you what a personification is in this painting, and then if anyone can give us another example of a personification, I want to hear it. Personification is when you take an element and you use people to represent it, to personify it. So those two figures blowing in, yes, those are the west winds. Okay, those are the west winds. It's the wind god Zephyr and his wife, but they're shown as human figures, and they're blowing and blowing so that Venus can be blown up onto the shore. Now, this does have a nice sense of perspective. It's a little shallow, though. Some other works from the Renaissance will get much more dramatic with the use of perspective. This is a tempera painting, and sometimes in the Renaissance period, if an artist or a client wanted to have a depiction of a nude woman, rather than saying nude woman or the name of the woman, the word Venus would be used. And this is something telling us something about the moral codes of Renaissance society. It was still not considered, I guess, appropriate to show a nude female figure unless it was assumed she was Venus. It was kind of code or a protective move. So this is Venus, and you'll see this story unfold a little bit more. It's interesting, too, that a work like this, you know, is bringing in Greco, when you bring in Greco-Roman myth in the Renaissance, those myths have now been deemed pagan by the Christian church to do with many gods. And the Catholic Church is saying, and Christian Church, one God. But there was still an acceptance of some of these myths. The High Renaissance. As we wind down our conversation today, I think we better touch on the High Renaissance in Italy, because this period from 1500 to 1525 is the full development, the pinnacle of Renaissance art. And Leonardo da Vinci's study of human proportions would be something to look at right away. So Leonardo da Vinci, the study of human proportions, is going to tell us a lot in the Renaissance. First of all, Leonardo is a very famous name from this period, an inventor, an artist, a scientist, a Renaissance man. The term Renaissance man usually means someone who did it all, literature, business, arts, and humanism is a major topic in the Renaissance. Man is the measure of all things. Man is the center of all things. Very different from earlier periods, man, humanism. Now, Renaissance man, there were women artists in the Renaissance. And this is a sort of a newer area of study because women, as you might expect, were not encouraged to go to art school. And it was just not, that was not the practice of the time. So many of the women that we know from the Renaissance, they did come from wealthy families, usually with rather liberal thinking parents who allowed for some art training for a very talented daughter, let's say. And we don't have a picture for the portrait of Philip II of Spain, but I would encourage you to Google this after the broadcast and see that there was a woman painter in the Renaissance named Sofonisba Anguissola. It's going to be hard to remember that name, but Anguissola. And she became a court painter for Philip II of Spain. She was a female artist. And, well, gives you sort of a start, gives women a start in the history of art here in the Renaissance, right? Now, Michelangelo is another important name from the Renaissance, and I'm wondering if we could look at Michelangelo's David from 1501 to 1504. Maybe this is a nice image to just sort of conclude our conversation today with. I was hoping we might have the sculptured David, but if we don't, I think a lot of us can fill it in imaginatively. Thank you. There we have it. Michelangelo started serious work as an artist at the age of 13. He had many high-placed patrons. He loved to sculpt. Don't forget that, because Michelangelo also did the frescoes on the Sistine ceiling, and he really preferred to sculpt. And he also could do both of those things, which is pretty unbelievable. The David may look Greek to you, but how is it Renaissance? There are some subtleties to think about. The body is large. It's marble work. But there is a personality here. David's face, as you continue your study of this work, David's face is pretty aggressive. He is not the detached Greek man. He's a fighter. And we're talking about the story of David and Goliath, but Goliath isn't even shown. The emphasis is on David and his power. His body has a lot more anatomical detail than Greek sculptures. He's got a special tension, a special energy. He's vibrant, and he's determined. And that those are good adjectives to describe some of the ideologies of the Renaissance. So I hope you've enjoyed this tour, and we will continue with some of these topics next week as we continue to study the arts and time. The Renaissance, the early Christian arts, just give you so many new forms to think about, new ideas. I hope you enjoyed this. You can digest the ideas. We'll come back and keep looking at the effect of Christianity on art next week.